All right, so continuing, we're gonna talk more opera talk because I have, wow, glitzy teeth tonight. But yeah, I really want to talk about, oh my gosh, I'm getting through, like, you know, I said yesterday I'm not gonna do the Estrano and I'm not gonna do the La Traviata, Misterioso, A Forse Lui Che Anima, that one. I'm not going to do that one. And then I'm like, no. And I'm rethinking. I can never cut it off. That's the trouble. As soon as you cut it off, it's like, well, what? I can't sing it. And then I know I can, because I have sung it. It's just getting, you know, the practice of it again. I did watch somebody today sing it. She was very beautiful. I'm sorry, I can't remember her name. But she was a current singer. Very smooth in the, what do we call it? I don't know, the libretto, the melody flow. Very smooth in her voice every time I went in. And out of the song, it's just like zooza, zooza, you know, beautiful. And she never had like galunky, what do we call that, when you chunk a song around, ha, I don't know, and when you're doing the glots, but when you're not supposed to do the glottal voice, and you do them anyway. Yeah, you show your steps. Yeah, that's interesting. Somebody was mentioning that yesterday. A teacher. It wasn't Di Donato. It was not her. It was somebody else. She was talking about that step business. That did not always show the steps so profoundly, or, you know, not profoundly, but, you know, obviously. That helps. It's a drudge, isn't it? Sometimes singing is such a drudge. Anyway, I went to cooking or baking, and I baked some of my these are so easy. They're chocolate flax. I put walnuts in there today, so that's what you see sparkling. It's the flax eggs I use with regular flour and oil. I don't ever use butter, so, because I'm a vegan. So these are vegan cookie. And cocoa, you use the cocoa powder, and then you stir. And you should also add a little bit of vanilla and baking powder and chocolate chips and some type of... Now, the weird thing about being a vegan is they say no honey, but it's, so yeah, so some type of a... I would prefer honey over the sugars, because I've been to Belize, I've seen it there lying in the street. I don't know why we have to eat the cane sugar. I don't, you know, it is so gross. Have you ever chomped on one of those canes? It is so disgusting. They used to sell that in the store, the groceries, I remember, the canes. Yeah, but the honey is always better. So maybe that's my one thing about being a vegan, that I still use honey. I sneak in the honey. They do have brown rice syrup now, which is pretty neat. They have an organic one. And they also have that agave nectar. But I don't know. These I just made with honey. So anyway, and there they go. They're cookies. Yeah. So what was I talking about? I don't know. Sometimes I just want to talk, and why not? Oh, I do. As a singer, I drink. Well, not today. This is a cold one. I just had lying around. But normally I drink. It's a really good tea. It's a throat coat tea. And you don't have to drink it all the time, like when you're singing, but or near your singing time, but it is good for a warmer on the vocals. Yeah. It's kind of gross though, actually, after a while, because I don't like to drink it all the time. It's some kind of an herb. It's called throat coat, and I don't know. It's a bunch of herbs in a tea bag, and it's a neat product that they make. If one day I will venture and I will discover what it is in that product, but right now not. I know I should talk about everything. Dance world, ballet world. Oh my gosh. Well, ballet world is like a competition show now. More and more and more. It's just competitions. I don't know. That's a place that's gone strange. Maybe that's why I like to sing opera, in preference to even, taking a little ballet class. Maybe that's why. Because, it's not that, well, it is. They still make them. I remember my mom, when she went to college, even then she had to do, she had to sing for one of their things. And she was not a singer, she said, but they made her sing anyway. And, so I know. It is competition. Get up there and push and push and sing and blah. I don't know. I guess the one thing about the arts I don't like is the competition ritual. And I've seen even the Russians now, they're doing it even really tackily. The Russians get really tacky. They have, a competition show. It's like they're, and then they'll have the dancers on, and then they'll have the judges, and they've turned it into the singing idol style, and so it gets really tacky, and it's just I hate to see dance turned into such a technophobe. No, not technophobe, that's the wrong word. This is still retrograde, remember, so everything is backwards and then it turned inside out. Okay, so it will be the techno overkill dancers. They go out there and they do their little technique, and then they get graded. I don't know. For me, it's like that's not what dance is all about. I would, prefer not to ever see that and dance together. I hate the competition part. I don't want to see the competition in singing either. I don't like it. I don't like any of it. I just want to see the singer sing or the dancer dance. Such a judgy world, aren't we? And I'm wondering why they have to have so many judges. Maybe it's is it a needy thing? Maybe I made the wrong choice as a director, and I hired the wrong person, and now we're stuck with them, so I'm a bad director, so I need 5, 10, or 10 judges, out there to make that decision to hire that person. I mean, it's kind of like, what's wrong with the director in the first place? He couldn't hire the right, or she couldn't hire the right person, that they need 5 or 10 judges to say so. That's what it starts to look like, is the inadequacy at the basic jurisdiction of directorships. It looks like they're just inadequate, that they need competitions to grab their hoo-hoos or whatever. And so, maybe they have no time. They have no time on their hands. Yes. Okay, so they have no time on their hands. Well, I don't know. That seems like a lazy output also, to use the competition world, just because the director doesn't have time on his hands. Even the dancers that are there with the other dancers can be judges. I mean, they're in the class. They go like who's that? No. And who's this? Yes. Dancers that you even have in your own company. If you're too bored as a director, or you just don't have the time because you're doing something amazing, let the dancers in your own company decide, you know, better than a competition show. I can't stand those. Yeah. Jeez, Manu. Yeah. Jeez, Manu, you know. Rawr. So anyway. Oh, well, I didn't tell you yesterday. I was talking about singing. I didn't tell you. I know, I have a really weirdo fear right now because this one dancer that I used to know, he was a sculptor, and then I saw this one thing he sculpted recently, and I'm like, uh-oh, you know, did he go too far, you know, did he just go too far in the sculpt, because in a way, you know, when you're using the body form and you're sculpting it, it's grotesque in a way, isn't it? The body itself is grotesque, and I just saw like this really skinny dog on one of these peta things, and he was grotesque, and I saw this really skinny woman in a sculpture, and she was grotesque, you know, I'm like, ugh, just can't handle any more grotesque art. So then I'm like, well, what was I talking about just now? I don't know. I was trying to get back to what I was saying with singing, and I was talking about my warm up. Yeah, let's talk about the warm-up. Now, yikes, I have a special warm-up. I will tell you my treat. When I trained when I was a little girl, really kind of around the same time I started ballet, 9 years old, eight years old, 9 years old, I was going to singing lessons. And my mom and the singing teacher, they forced, you know, the recorder, press the recorder, and it was one of those old tapes. So I actually cheat, and I play my old tape. I moved it into this digital mode. So I have this old tape of myself going through the scales with my teacher when I was a little baby-like girl. And it's so funny because it's my voice, and it's my tiny voice, you know, my young voice, my most naive voice, my most innocent, you know, the virgin voice. And it's hysterical. I love it. I love starting with her because she is so young and just like pouncy with the notes, and she doesn't care. And that's me also. So it's kind of neat. So I use her as my beginning, and then I go off. I have a couple women that I listen to in their warm-ups, and then I go with them a little bit on their CEOs and all of that. And then I have another one that I love. It's one of the Fleming videos. Where she's giving some help. She's giving some help to a woman, woman in a green dress, and so I listen to her for like another couple minutes, and I go with her and sing her Alma, and it's all about getting into the head voice, and then I'm ready. So yeah, so I use those three, and then I'm ready to sing like a crepuscole, and then off to vocalize. But yeah, isn't that neat? It's so fun to, and when I got back here to the United States, I found those tapes, and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is excellent, you know, because it's me, you know, it's me, it's my voice. And I was so like, I mean, when you are young like that, you're like, it's almost like you have no fear. I have complete fear now as a grown woman. Oh my gosh, I'm afraid Friday. Okay, but as a little girl like that, I was not afraid. I would sing, I would just do what that teacher said, and I would obey her. You know, I was just like, okay, you know, what you say, I do, you know. And it's almost like as we're older now, the fear, you know, fear of performing, all of these things are just like, I'm getting, drowned in it, drowned in all of these fears, you know, the older I'm getting, fear, the fears are climbing, you know, with the waters above, you know, so it's kind of interesting. So the one that has no fear was me when I was young girl, you know, just, that's it, you know, and it's all later. You know, it's longer and later in our lives, we get more and more fear. Or how do we stop the fear? I don't know. Because, you know, it's like that, you know, if you perform a lot, it goes away. And I've been in a lot of ballet companies where we didn't perform enough. And it was not conducive to the fear removal factor. It was like, oh my gosh, big performance, you know. It's like, I didn't want that. I just wanted, yeah, we're performing again, you know, every couple nights or whatever. I wanted that type. But a lot of companies, they just don't. They don't have that again and again. Because that really helps remove it, the more you perform. So, yay. Okay, so I think that's all I had to say tonight. I haven't been listening to any. I'm gonna go visit the Opera News. Imagine what to say. There's always a new diva or something I have to listen to, or a new great. But then yet not. There's not that many that are great. And that's another trouble, you know, the arts themselves, I don't know about that escalation of opera. You know, it's always going to be like a small little clatch group that sing, and it seems like that's all we're ever going to have. I don't think it's ever going to really be mainstream. It is a little bit in Europe, it tries, but they have good audiences, they have very big audience sizes, you know. They've called it the Greek Colosseums, and they're singing, you know, that type of thing. But I don't know. I don't know about here. Here in America, we're kind of like, it's not just a rarity, it's a strangity. We are not... We're treated, we're thought of as by immatures. That's what I can say. The arts in America are thought of by others through their immature brain. They're thinking of ballet through their immature brain when they talk to you. Oh, you do this, or they go, oh, and you sing like that. They are talking to you through an immature brain, and they just don't drop it. And it's so tiring, so tedious. But that's America. And for some reason, that immature brain has not, you know, gone away. Just hasn't gone away. So yeah, that's 9 times out of 10. Every person you meet is going to be that immature brain when you're talking about the arts. It's very, very tedious. Anyway. Yow. That was fun. That was a fun relive. I've told you about my warm-up. My warm-up girl. Oh my gosh. And I was an ugly duckling. I sang today while the blossoms still, what do they do? Cling to the vine. I'll taste your strawberries. I'll drink your sweet wine. I sang that one. I sang, did I sing tomorrow? I'm not sure. I it was today, I think. And then she did force me to sing Somewhere Over the Rainbow, yeah. But yeah, that was my singing teacher. Before I joined choir, later on in like Utah, I joined choir. And that was just at high school. And we sang at Banks. And I had one girl, I remember her well, you know, I can give her a hug right now. I remember her so well that she had such a beautiful voice. She was a gorgeous soprano. really pure tones, and oh, I was a mess compared to her. Just a mess. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, that's the way it goes. I don't know if she's still singing. Yeah. And also I sang at the Radford a little bit. We did, I think, a few singing in the mall or something. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I sang a little bit there. But the fun was really when I was with my teacher, a little child, 9, 10, and 11, and singing with that piano. That was a great, great time. Anyway, ciao.